Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to the CM Mentors Podcast. My name is Matt Graves. My co-host each week is Kyle Grandel. What's up, Kyle?
Hey, Matt. How you doing, man?
Good, man. I'm waiting for Alex to get you that poster green screen behind you so we can put something cool back there.
I don't know why everybody's hating on my white wall. I think it's fantastic. I did a lot to get this wall, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, I like it. It matches your shirt, and so it all kind of, you know, it's nice.
Well, what I'll do is, if I do an actual green wall, I'll just paint it green, and then we can put all kinds of crazy shit back there. It'll be great.
That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to let Alex and Morgan come up with whatever we're putting back there. You don't even choose.
I like it. I like it, man. Let's do this a whole new direction.
Man, you want to introduce Ted?
Yeah, sounds great. So thanks for tuning in, everybody. We have a really awesome guest this week, a little different flavor than what we usually do, but super excited about it because it's a great lead in to kind of the early stages of a project and early stages of construction. It's about finding the right talent. So this week we have Ted Keyport. He's a principal headhunter with Keyport Search. He specializes in engineering and manufacturing sectors. He's got a degree from the University of St. Thomas, representing Minnesota, all right. And then he also supported my company, Dell Management, with some recent hires. And I've known Ted for quite a few years back, very dear friend of mine, great guy. So looking forward to bringing him on.
You get this opportunity to ask him all the hard questions, and you got him on recorded camera now too, so we can't lie to you, right?
Well, now that he's going to be on, we're going to
There he is.
Hey, Ted. Hey, how you doing? Great, man. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Awesome. So Ted, give us a little bit about your background. You know, so obviously, you know, we introduced you. You're a headhunter, and what got you into that? And you know, give us a little bit of your story.
I totally fell into it by accident. I graduated with an English degree from St. Thomas, which was an excellent financial decision. Very glad I did that. Very wise. I wanted to travel a bit before I started, you know, my sure to be lucrative English degree career. And I wanted to go to Korea to teach English. And in order to go to Korea, you have to get a visa, and the visa process takes a long time. So I needed a temp job for like 6 months, got a temp job at this staffing agency I had worked at as a recruiter for them. And then when I got back from Korea, they hired me on and, you know, was in the industry, you know, just working agency, you know, headhunting for, I don't know, 6 or 7 years or something, and launched my own firm 2021 after COVID. And that's what I've been doing ever since.
Yeah, very cool. So what is it about the headhunting that really excites you? I mean, what draws you to it and keeps you in it?
Well, I think it's every search that you get is very different. It's never really the same thing twice. I mean, you can work on the same job for a company that's hiring a couple of different people, but you're always dealing with a different person in a different life or career stage with different goals, and the company needs are always very different. So when it works, it's awesome because you happen to, you know, really dramatically change somebody's life in a way that can be difficult to do otherwise. But you know, I mean, it's a roller coaster. It's up and down. So you can do all the work and counteroffer or goofy thing on the background check or failed drug test, and the whole thing falls apart. You have no control over that. Mm-hmm. So
you launched your own company in 2021 after COVID. Did COVID play a role in that in some way, or was it just that?
Yeah. You know, I'd wanted to do something like it for a long time. But I had like a list of things I wanted to learn, basically. And the last thing on my list of things to learn was survive a recession. So I had to, you know, during COVID, I mean, I remember I had clients, you know, these are, you know, companies I'm working with that have asked me to find, you know, people for them, that in January and February of 2020, you know, I had live active searches, very healthy pipeline, things were going great. I had, you know, sort of late February, early March, it started to feel a little weird. I had some of my clients that had exposure to Asia, were starting to put a hold on hiring. And it was a lot of like, hey, call us in 2 weeks. This thing in Wuhan is freaking us out. I don't know, my boss just said to put everything on hold for 2 weeks. And then of course, you know, we go into lockdown here and pretty much everything evaporated overnight. And it didn't really start up again until August for me. That's when we started to get sort of a pipeline of business start to flow back through. I was very lucky because my background is manufacturing, and specifically I was doing a lot of welders and machinists and stuff at the time. And that was a vertical where companies, you know, they always need welders all the time.
Right.
They always need maintenance people. They always need machinists. They always need machine operators. It doesn't matter what's going on in the world. If the machines are running, you need people for those roles, and they're not easy to find. So, you know, being able to offer that kept me afloat. And then once I had figured out how to survive a recession, I was like, well, I have nothing else to learn working for somebody else, and left. And now here I am, Keyport Technical Search.
Absolutely.
Your bucket list is way different than mine. I don't think I've ever had survive a recession on my bucket list.
Well, in recruiting, it's the whole business is tied to the health of the job market. If the job market isn't healthy, then your business isn't healthy because companies won't pay you to find people for them. So I'd been in this bull market my whole career. And so I knew this was going to happen at some point. And so I wanted to figure out how to do it before on somebody else's dime before I went off on my own. And so, not to say I didn't like working for the people I was working for or anything. It was great, wonderful people, and I learned a lot. But I've kind of a weird practice now. I still do a lot of that manufacturing, a lot of skilled trades recruiting. But I'm starting to get a little bit more kind of in the construction world. I'm doing more sort of higher level engineering type positions, some ops, you know, that kind of thing as well. I don't know if you want me to say this or not, Kyle, but I recruited Kyle back in the day for a job. Didn't go anywhere, but we stayed in touch and joined the golf league together. And, you know, we've just been buddies for a long time. And I offered some advice to him when he was starting his own business. And so I take credit for all the success that he's had.
All of it.
Yep. Every ounce of it is thanks to me. So you're welcome.
Cheers.
Yeah. So he asked me to do a search here recently, and we wrapped that up and invited me on, and here I am.
Yeah. So cool. We did the getting to know you a little bit. Do you want to jump into the getting to know you questions? Just, we'll get this out of the way. It's a fun little thing we try to do at the beginning just to kind of break the ice, but the ice is already broken. But quick question. When you're not headhunting folks, what's your favorite thing to unwind and recharge?
I'm a runner. I'm a marathoner. I try to do one a year. I'll be doing Twin Cities Marathon this year. If any of your listeners will be there, you should cheer for me. I'll be the dorky looking guy with the glasses. I'm a chess guy. I play a lot of online chess, sort of in between calls and stuff. Other than that, you know, two kids. Oldest one just started kindergarten, so we're going through that whole, you know, school bus routine and all that kind of stuff now. And so it's a lot of running and chasing kids for me these days.
At least you got to keep chasing or keep running, because like once I had my kids, I almost stopped doing everything. It felt like.
You have to make time. You have to, there's no other way about it. And the nice thing about a race, having a race on your schedule, is that you can't not do your training runs, because you won't finish the race. You just paid all this money for the race. You damn well better get your runs in. So, but it does mean you're sore all the time, which is that's one thing nobody ever told me about being a parent, how often you have to get up from where you're sitting. Have you noticed that, Kyle?
I've been doing squats for 6 years. My legs have never been stronger.
Yeah, well, see, for me, they're always sore just because I just had a long run get in, and they're so it's like, oh, I have to go upstairs again. Oh, I have to climb the stairs, go down the stairs. I have to get up and grab this thing. I got to go get water for this kid or milk for that kid.
Oh man! Next question: if you could have any tool or piece of equipment named after you, what would it be?
Oh man. Headset. When I'm talking about that, I mean, these days I use either AirPods or just a phone on speaker, but I've tried all the little headsets with the little microphone, and all the noise canceling options, all that kind of stuff. And I have opinions on what works and what doesn't work with those. You don't want the in-ear, you want the over-the-ear you know, things here. You don't want it to go all the way over your head because it messes up your hair and it starts to itch after a while. You want something that goes over one ear, but you want to be able to adapt it to the other ear so you can switch it over because one ear might get sore. Your ear might start to hurt from it, always hearing stuff through that ear. So
you're about to unveil the TED port.
Yeah. The TED port. Yeah. That's it. Yeah. Key port, search port, whatever. I don't know. That's
here we go.
I should have named the company that, Searchport. That works.
It's not too late.
Yeah, well, it is. I'm committed. I got the email address.
What's your go-to habit that helps you start your day right?
I mean, really, it's the running more than anything. Puts you in a good zen state. Keeps you focused. Gets you out of that lazy early morning thing, grogginess. Other than that, maybe coffee.
Coffee's the number one.
Definitely get that.
So last question here. When you kind of started getting into the construction industry, what's the most unexpected thing you've learned as you've gotten into the construction industry?
Well, you know, recruiting in this space, I think in other industries when you're recruiting in them, especially manufacturing, I think in a lot of ways, like construction is a meritocracy. It's if you're good, you're busy. And if you're not, you're always looking for work, you know? And so that sort of translated very easily for me between manufacturing and construction. But I'm also noticed that, like, with all the different types of construction that can happen, things aren't always that I would have imagined on paper are applicable, aren't always all that applicable, right? I mean, somebody that's building strip malls and somebody that's building apartment buildings and somebody that's building pet food manufacturing facilities are way different skill sets for all three. Mm-hmm. You know, I've done searches for companies that are doing dry fertilizer storage, that are doing geothermal, you know, heating technology, that are doing, you know, big industrial plants, that are environmental engineering, all sorts of stuff. And every single one of those companies, they need somebody that is already doing that work or been very adjacent to it. You can't always be as creative or flexible with backgrounds when it comes to that. So learning some of those details and getting a sense for the different ways that companies sort of understand talent is been, you know, it's just been different than some of the other industries I've worked in.
Well, that's true, because I've seen people that come, like, they're in residential and they try to come to commercial and it's just a completely different ball game. Or even once they're in commercial, they've been building 7-Elevens, they're in public storage buildings their whole life. Now that they're going to go build a new high school or something, right? And like, that's just totally a completely different animal. And so
totally. I had a candidate who had been doing like coffee facilities, think like a Starbucks, like working for the corporate company, and they were, you know, managing the construction of all these new, you know, coffee, you know, retail sales. I don't even call that retail
shop.
And it was like, you know, she was super, super sharp, like really, really intelligent, great communicator. Everything they wanted on paper was checked off. And the company had expressed openness to me getting creative with the types of construction they were doing, but they just couldn't. This other company, I don't want to, you know, expose anybody, but what they were making was very different than that. And I don't think the candidate understood how different it was. Because that's the challenge with recruiting, right? And interviewing people is people don't always know what their limitations are. They know enough to be like, oh, yeah, I could totally learn that. And then the reality is well, actually, you know, you don't know enough to know how much you don't know.
Yeah.
Well, no, to the same point you're making, Ted, that's a struggle we always have too. You know, our customers, bless them, they're amazing, we love them, but it's very difficult to always have somebody that has their exact experience to put on a project when they need it.
Right.
Doing that is, oh man, it's tricky, and it's tricky when you don't have a company big enough to have 10 people just sitting on a bench at home, just waiting for the call from you that hey, it's time to go to work.
That's what happens is no company has 10 people sitting on the bench. They'll propose a few resumes. The owner will say, yeah, we're going to start, you know, next quarter. And he said, these people are available next quarter. They wait 4 quarters. And now it's like, hey, what happened to Joe? He was going to be my guy. Well, Joe, like, you slept. Joe's on like another project already. And so that's always a fun conversation.
It's not often, if you're recruiting on a national level, you can find anybody you want. It's just not always going to be on your timeline. And that's the challenge, I mean, that it, you and I, with the search we just did, Kyle, I mean, that was the big challenge for us, was the scheduling. I mean, we were able to source people that were skilled, and it was like finding people that could start at the right time, that could go through training at the right time, and then could be on site at the customer at the right time. That was the challenge. And that was a lot of pressure for me, man. Like, that was like, we started this thing like early summer, and the dude needed to start, like, I think originally it was like mid August or something.
Yeah. Originally mid August. Yep. Yep.
And you know, it's like late July, and I've got a couple candidates and everything, but we're like not close to an offer. And like, I'm thinking to myself, like, he better hire somebody quick here on this list, because they got to do 2 week notice. If you want to do any training or anything, you need to start that process early. I mean, and then they, like, the whole getting them on site is going to be a thing. And there's the transportation, there's all this other stuff. It can take, you know, between offer accepted to actual start date, you know, it's sometimes people want more than 2 weeks notice. So you might have a month or a month and a half before people can actually, you know, be effective in their roles. And the more you need somebody to be turnkey, the less wiggle room you have, because you can't train this or that deficient skill because you don't have enough time. So it was, I mean, I think the gentleman we got is a rock star, and he's going to kick ass. But I think in general, if you've got tight deadlines, it's one of the things I tell my clients is, like, if you need this person to start in 3 months, like, we better be interviewing right now, because who knows how long it'll take to go through the process.
Yeah, well, absolutely. And, you know, talking about it, we're very excited about it. You know, it's starting up next week here, see how the individual does. And, you know, a lot of that comes down to this search and the time that we put into it, working together and planning and, right, you know, talking through and making sure that we were on the same page. Can you share a little bit about maybe, you know, what that looked like on your end of things, as far as, you know, how did you set us up for success? You know, maybe it's a difference between what makes successful and unsuccessful hires. You know, some of those things for, on your end of things, you know, what made it easier for you or more difficult too?
Yeah. Well, so we can kind of play this out like a case study. So I'll just sort of set the stage here. The need was for a construction manager with an electrical controls background who could be on site on a particular project in, I believe it was Indiana, for, you know, 6 to a year-long project, and then could be deployed out on other projects in the future and kind of rotated between clients and projects and so on. So had to be pretty sharp, obviously, you know, as an owner's rep type of a situation, had to be able to operate more or less autonomously, because you're not going to be there to, like, help them do their work. You know, they're on site by themselves, essentially, managing subs and stuff. And they also had to be able to be sort of customer facing and be able to talk to customers and be able to communicate with customers. And as you guys know, in construction, you don't, sometimes you get people who are not maybe people, if you know what I mean. Not always great communicators.
What? In construction? Never.
Never. Well, in engineering too. I mean, you get a lot of nerds in engineering. I don't mean that as a knock.
It's true.
Look at these glasses, guys. I mean, I'm one of them too. You know, for a search like this, there was a very sort of specific type of a profile. I mean, we basically needed a younger or like somebody that was almost Kyle level of technical expertise in the areas that Kyle knows really well.
Another Kyle, though.
You can't have another Kyle. No, we don't want more than one.
No, there are no others, folks. There are no others.
Thank God.
So what ended up happening, if you remember, is I went to market. So we were talking early summer. We want this person to start late August. So I've got a couple of months to get candidates and get them into the process. So I sourced, I think it was 3 resumes at first. None of them were even close. Not even remotely what you needed at the time. Great people, great candidates, awesome people I hope to place in the future, but not for this particular role. It was too much controls, not enough construction management, or too much construction management, but not the right kind of construction management, or whatever. But sometimes for me, you know, when I'm recruiting on these roles, I don't always know what's like what you want yet, right? I know what you told me you wanted, but that isn't always the same as what you want. And I deal with this with companies all the time where you have this sort of role that's multifaceted and has all these different aspects to it. And I'll give you someone that matches what you told me you wanted on paper, and you're not interested. The company's not interested because there's some sort of intangible piece, or there's this particular factor was actually, now that we're looking at a resume and seriously considering interviewing somebody, I'm not seeing this, and that's a concern for me. That kind of thing happens all the time. So the no's often help more than the yeses for these types of things. So all three of those were no. And then I came back, I think, with two more, right? And they were both qualified, and they were both people you wanted to talk to. One gentleman was very experienced, been doing this for a long time. And then there was the young up and comer. And you guys would be amazed at how often companies are interested in the young up and comer. Because there's a ton of potential there. There's tons of, you can sort of, it reminds you of what you were like at that age. Often you're looking at a comp range that isn't quite as high. I'm not sure if that was the case in this particular instance, but oftentimes when with these types of searches, the young up and comer will, I would say, I'm just gonna guess, 30, 40% of the time, they end up beating out the more experienced candidate. Mm-hmm. And, you know, worked our way through offer phase, and here you are.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and, you know, the interesting thing about that story is really that part that you just landed on about the young up and comer, because that's a great direct tie in, you know, with the whole point of the show that we're doing here. And, you know, it kind of, maybe even not so much our case study, but in other ones, is there some certain factors that you see that leads to that happening? I mean, anything that you can share that's, you know, basically advice related to next generation as they're looking to, if they have to switch roles, you know, what kinds of things are helping them stick out and helping them get that edge?
Well, from my perspective, when I'm working with candidates, I've got to pitch them to the companies, and I have to explain why you should hire this person or why you should be interested in this candidate. And there's a couple things about a profile or a background that would make somebody more attractive in that case. That makes my job easier when I'm pitching them. First, a lot of times companies really like to see progressive series of steps up within the same organization, because what that means is that this is somebody who's been identified as a high performer, and their employer is trying to retain them by promoting them. That's not always true, and a lot of times you'll have really, really sharp and skilled people that are not being promoted for whatever reason. That's one of the most common reasons why, when I'm talking to candidates, they're looking to make a move. But in a lot of cases, you know, you'll have I started as a, you know, project engineer for your specific type of a role here, let's say construction management. Started as a project engineer, and then I moved into, you know, a project manager role or sort of a lead engineering position or something. And then I moved into this, and then I moved into this, and then I moved into this. And you can kind of look at the profile at this one organization or sometimes multiple organizations. You can see the progression. You can see how they're climbing up and how their employer is sort of rewarding them for the work that they're doing. So that's one thing that makes the case easier, is to be able to talk about that sort of internal growth. But another thing that can help a lot is just interview performance, how they do in the interview. Being a good communicator is obviously, from an interviewing perspective, really, really, really critical. And interview skills are something that can be learned. It's not innate. I've done a lot of work in manufacturing with people that are on the spectrum that are not always, it feels to them sometimes like interviews are, it's like you're on stage at a play and everybody has the script except you. And you don't really, why are they asking me this question? I don't understand why they care. What my biggest weakness? Okay, well, this is what I'm bad at. You know, they just don't understand the context of the questions, just because interviewing is not like most social interactions. It's a very different way of communicating, and you're focused on different things, and there's this subtext that's going on beneath the surface with whatever you're saying. So I think developing interviewing skills, if you're a young person in the construction management field, I mean, that's going to be really, really, really critical to do. being able to point to successes at your job, that's going to be really, really critical. And then, you know, making yourself available for recruiters. I mean, obviously that's the other thing that makes it easy for me to find you is if you're on LinkedIn and your page is updated and you're visible. If I'm recruiting on a national basis for a role like the one we were just talking about, and not everybody's going to be interested in a traveling gig like this, of course, but if I'm a recruiter and I'm working on a national basis, I'm not scouring local job boards. You know, I'm not going to have a deep developed network of people I know in your market that I can call that are local to wherever the job site is and you know, start to work my way through the referral network. There are people that do that. But for the most part, I'm going to find you probably on LinkedIn. And if not LinkedIn, Indeed is kind of the only other decent one right now. As frustrating as Indeed it can be to work with, it's one of the more populated job databases out there.
Yeah, well, and I just want to hit really quick, and then I'll hand it over to you, Matt. I see you want to talk. But that point you made about having your page updated, LinkedIn, super, super important. Because on my end of things, as the hiring employer, the first thing I do, so I get a resume from Ted, and I look through it. And if it looks like it's probably close, next thing I'm going to do is check on the person's profile. Because right. I want to see, does it match the resume they're submitting? Are they a real person? Do they have stuff filled out? Because in my mind, if your LinkedIn profile is not at least somewhat up to date and you got a picture and it looks personable, then how do I expect you to take your job seriously enough to put you in front of customers and to be my person when I'm not there? So right. I need to know that you're taking it as seriously as you should be. And to me, that's one data point.
Pictures, one comment about that, because you brought it up. There are people out there that don't want their picture on LinkedIn just for privacy reasons, which is like totally fine. You don't have to do that on LinkedIn, where you can use like a picture of you from a distance or something with a fish in your hand. That seems pretty popular for some reason, at least in my circles. But everything else you're saying, dead on. I mean, it's okay to even have like under each job to have just like one or two sentences. It's really all you need. You don't need much more than that. Yep. About what you're doing and because what you're trying to do is keyword. You're putting keywords in so that I can find you. Right.
Yeah.
Anything more than a couple, like two or three bullets per job isn't really necessarily necessary. It might help add more keywords, but what you'll often find is you start to repeat yourself after that. And that doesn't add a lot of value.
Can I take a shot at really bad recruiters for a second on LinkedIn?
Yeah, dude.
So I'll get you. Oh, I know. There's some really bad people on there where, you know, like I'm not looking for a job, but like I get DMs from recruiters all the time, right? Like emails, what they call them. And I got one just the other day. I worked for a mechanical contractor before, and I got, you know, from a mechanical contractor, that'd be it for a project manager position. Like, hey, you'd be great. You know, with all your experience, you'd be great for this position. But they said, based on your role at Alt CMO, which is the marketing company I've founded and working on, like based on your role at Alt CMO, you'd be really great for this marketing or this mechanical project manager experience project. I was like,
yeah,
you're awful. Like,
it's probably AI that did that.
It's automated and AI.
LinkedIn added some AI functionality recently, which. Perfect. I don't know. I have no idea how effective it is.
It's a turnoff, I think, because if people are like, if they're pulling the wrong, and that's not even my current position shown on, or my most current position shown on my thing. So it's like somehow the AI pulled it or whatever. And it's just, I don't know. You got to be, when you're doing recruiting, to me, it doesn't seem like it's a, you know, it's not a game of percentages. Like, you can't just pray and spray, right? You've got to like be more personal, right? Like you're getting somebody, you're asking them to quit their job, follow you to something else, right? And you got to have a personal touch.
It's you know, I think if you want to a high percentage hit rate on your emails, you're dead on right. Not everybody cares about that, believe it or not. There are companies out there that they just pay for thousands and thousands of emails and they want to use all of them. And so, I mean, that's how it works is you basically get the type of it's called LinkedIn Recruiter account. There's different sort of levels of it, depending on how big you are and how much you want to pay. But it's pricey. It's very expensive. It gives you, I think I have like 350 a month or something. But here, if you want to screw those people over, here's what you do. So when you reply,
I'm listening. Hold on, taking notes.
Okay. When you reply to a message on LinkedIn, even if it's a decline, that recruiter gets their in-mail credit back. So I got 350 a month, and it's, if somebody replies to the message, I get the in-mail credit back. So if I send out 10 messages and nobody responds, I have 340 left. If I send out 10 messages and five people respond, I have 345 left. So if you don't reply to the message, you just let it hang like that, then they never get that credit back. Now, I mean, again, these recruiters that are blasting out, you know, thousands and thousands of these things every week are gonna, they don't care if one is responded to or not, but it's at least a little bit of a, you know, like,
well, yeah. I mean, I guess the strategy is, you know, you're going to pay somebody $20 an hour to manage this LinkedIn profile or this account or whatever you've got, and you're buying all the credits. You're not paying for a high level, you know, executive recruiter to go actually personally target people. And if you get anybody say, "Hey, I'm interested," they probably push them on to somebody that's an actual recruiter to go have the conversation. I guess that's right. I don't know. Well, it doesn't mean I like it.
The other thing I'll tell you is when you get those messages, click on the recruiter's profile and look at it, and look at their tenure. If they're jumping,
they're all agency, 3 months or less.
Well, there you go. Then they're probably not worth working with because they're not going to have any relationships you can leverage at all. You want somebody that is long tenure. They can have made a change to a new company recently, but you want long tenure because recruiters that are good, at least on the agency side. So I'm not talking about people that are, you know, corporate recruiters that are in-house at a company, but agency recruiters that are successful build up a book of business. And if they were to leave and go somewhere else, they leave that book of business behind. They don't always get to take it with them. Some in rare occasions that'll happen, but for the most part, you don't get to keep your book of business. So if you're jumping from job to job to job to job to job, it might take an agency a year to figure out that you're not maybe all that good. And so you're not going to have developed a book of business at that point. So from your perspective, you're like, whatever, I'll just try this other agency. And then you jump to the new one. And then you're there for a year and you jump to the new one and then jump to the new one, so on and so on and so on and so on. So those types of people are not worth working with. Now, but if you do get a message from a recruiter that's been at the same agency for 15 years that has been sort of like you can see they've been there for a long time, or maybe they've had a 5-year stint here and a 10-year stint here, or, you know, they've been at the same place for 4 years or something, and then they were out of school before. That's probably someone that's worth talking to because they're going to have a network. They're going to have a book of business. So even if the message they sent you is lame, just reply to it and be like, "Hey, I'm not interested in this job. This is what I would be interested in." And then they'll remember that and they'll message you again. They might not message you. Like I have people that I messaged, you know, a year ago about a job. Maybe we talked to the phone, maybe we didn't. And they're like, "Hey, I'm not looking for that shift, or I'm looking for this, or I'm looking for that." And I say, "Okay, cool. I'll reach out again next time I have that." And then a year later I have that. I can just reply to that message again and they'll be like, "Oh yeah, I never talked to this guy, but he messaged me. Okay, I'll talk to him." And now suddenly we have, there is some sort of semblance of a relationship already there to leverage. And I appreciate the candidate, you know, saving everybody time, and they appreciate me not reaching out with the crappy job they're not interested in. Right. So it's that's the way when you're looking long term at sort of building relationships with recruiters. Not all of them are worth your time, but the ones that are usually going to be the people that have been at, you know, in the game for a while at the same place, and who are going to have people in your network or in your field that they're connected to and work with and can bring you opportunities. But it might take years talking to the same person before they actually get you the job that you want.
I've had those thoughts when you see somebody, you know, and you get, I don't know what it is about the construction industry, but you'll see, like, you know, some lady who's bounced from, she was a real estate agent, and then she worked at a med spa for a year, and now she's a recruiter for 3 months, and she has all the jobs that's going to change your life.
Like, yeah, right. I mean, you know, it's not impossible that she'd have a cool job. You know, I mean, it's when I hire somebody, I'll probably hire somebody that they might even have a background like that, right? Because recruiting is sales. It is a sales job. You have to win the search agreement, the contract from the company, and you have to go, you know, source it and pitch the job to people. But it's you know, so the skill set can be adjacent to a lot of other industries, but you know, if you're looking to build a long-term relationship with somebody, if you want to have options, if you're ever to be laid off or you're looking for work in a couple of years or something, then you want people that are experienced, that are experts in your specific field, what you do. Yeah. And that means, you know, you reply to those messages, even if you aren't interested, and who knows what'll happen. I mean, that person you're describing, in you know, maybe 5-10 years from now, they're still at the same agency, and this was just their first job. Nobody goes to school for recruiting. You fall into it.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
You just completely. It's one of those jobs. You ask anybody, it's like, oh, then nobody grew up hoping to do this. It was just a complete accident. They fell into it.
Well, and Ted, would you say that there's been maybe a change in recruiting trends, like maybe old school versus new school recruiting?
Oh, yeah. Back in the day, man, they used to do. If you watch Mad Men, I think there's some headhunter characters. It was like, I've talked to some of the old timers that are retired and asked them what it was like, and it was, you know, pre internet, you know, back in the 70s and 80s and stuff. Like, you'd figure out where people went to church. You know, and you'd go to mass and you'd find them in the parking lot afterwards, and you'd hand them a card, and like it was, or you'd like leave them a note under their windshield at work in the parking lot, you know, like that kind of thing would happen. It was a lot of headhunters were like former executives that already had all the relationships. This was like something you could do if you lost your job, because you knew all the players and they all knew you and they all trusted you. So you'd have a lot of more of that kind of thing. It wasn't so much of a technical search process like it is now, where it's much more of a what we might think of as a traditional sales type of a industry. It was very much like, so if you had a candidate that, like, if you wanted to call somebody, you had to get their home number or their work number, and people don't always want to talk to you when they're at work. So how else are you going to like get a hold of this person to present whatever it is you're working on? So you also had recruiters would have a much smaller caseload of searches that they're working on at any given time. I mean, I'll have at any given moment somewhere between, you know, 5 to 15 jobs that I'm working on. I'm a contingent recruiter. I'm not a retained guy. Retained recruiters, where, like, do you guys know the difference between contingent and retained?
I do, but the audience might. Go ahead.
Okay. So a retained recruiter, you engage them in a search. If you're a company and you're looking to hire a construction manager, you'll call up this company, this recruiter firm, and you'll retain them. So you'll basically pay a portion of the eventual fee upfront to the agency. And a contingent search, basically you don't get paid anything at all until you fill it. And there's advantages and disadvantages to each. With contingent, you can take a higher volume of searches. And my strategy is just like, I take a ton of searches that are like the same role at different companies. And then every time I talk to a candidate, I could be like, okay, I've got this company, they need this person. I have this company, they need the same person. This company is the same person. Which job is closest to your house? And oftentimes that's the big determiner, is like, this one pays the most, but it's like 45 minutes away, versus that one pays almost as much, but it's 5 minutes away. And people are almost always more interested in the 5 minute away job, just because for obvious reasons. So not sure if that answered your question. I kind of went on a tangent there.
I don't remember what the question was. What was the question? Old school, new school?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, there's a question? That's not like us. That's just not right.
So what's the, I've thought about that before when it comes up with, you know, a lot of stuff, like, you know, in construction management, for instance, like if my internet goes down on the job side, I'm like, well, I can't do anything. I got to go home. My email doesn't work. Right. Like, and I've had those thoughts where, like, the whole world, I mean, you know, I was, you know, the millennials, right. We got internet when we were like, you know, 12 or 10 or whatever, right? Like, so we kind of grew up with the internet, but like, oh, there was a time period pre-internet. Like, how did the world work? Like, something like recruiting, where it's very, like, today's day and age, you just said, like, how do you do it? You want LinkedIn or Indeed, right? Like, those things are new technology, right? I mean, they've been around for, you know, 15 years or whatever. And, but like, you know, finding a project manager in Indiana, if you're in Minnesota, like, how the hell could you ever do that, you know, 30 years ago? It's like impossible.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it was, there were, you know, agency, like, did you ever hear the term Kelly Girls? It was one of the first staffing companies that existed was Kelly. It's now Kelly Services. But Kelly Services would do, it was like a temp agency for like secretaries and stuff, like assistants. And so if you had somebody that was out sick or whatever, you could call Kelly Girls and they would send, because at the time, obviously, almost all secretaries were women. And this is, so that's what they did. And they were, they kind of pioneered the whole industry. And so they would have their own internal database of phone numbers and resumes. And people would know if you're looking for a job, you call Kelly Girls and you go there and they would, you know, basically it wasn't really so much of a, it wasn't like it is now where it's like, here's a resume of someone I think you should interview. And they agree to interview. And then you go out and have an interview and that's that. It was more like, here's somebody that we've predetermined is qualified and we will deploy them out when you say you want them. And so
they like a substitute teacher more.
Yeah, exactly. That kind of a thing where it's like, I think Kelly has a substitute teacher like service now. He's like, teacher calls. But they, yeah, basically that's what it is where we have a stack of people and on the bench, we were talking about on the bench earlier, people on the bench that are ready to go. And they're all qualified for your job according to the standards we've agreed, you know, up front. You tell us when you need somebody and you would just call them up and they'd have somebody there the next day. So there were services like that existed, but at the headhunter level, you know, when we're looking at, you know, these real big, you know, C-suite jobs or, you know, mid-level management jobs and stuff like that, or like technical engineering type positions. I mean, it was, you know, there were some recruiters that could do it, but in a lot of cases it was just you had a buddy that used to do this and you just try to recruit him every time you took him out to eat at the restaurant or whatever. Like it was a lot of deals happened at the bar or in the restaurant. Now it's almost all over.
Back in the day, was it more headhunters were mostly executive level positions? Where today, I mean, you might find like a construction manager, even assistant construction manager, right? They're filling all those levels.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was the original time. I mean, you'd have some agencies that, and I mean, again, it was often former executives. There would be, you'd have somebody that would find you an executive. And usually what would happen is, I've actually had this kind of thing happen before a couple of times where, well, they'll be like, here's the list of people. Bring us somebody from this list of people. You would persuade them. That's when you would have, you know, it was like PI stuff, right? Where you're like stalking their church or where they work or where their kids go to school or something, trying to catch them and hand them your card and offer to buy them lunch or dinner or something. And, you know, people would keep, they'd have, you know, a secret place at their house or something or a drawer somewhere where they'd have recruiters' cards. And when they were ready and looking for work, they could call people on that list and start getting some meetings set up. And so, it's not like that now. Now it's a lot more, there's so many more people that are doing it. Tech has made it, you know, obviously very different. There's a lot more AI. There's a lot more data doing. You're working from databases. It's a lot more impersonal and, you know.
Yeah, so we've been talking a little bit about the process. You know, we've kind of gone through a case study a little bit for, you know, working with us as well as, you know, some of the do's and the don'ts behind it. Now, when you actually get to the placement, you know, what are some things you've seen as far as differences between maybe successful versus unsuccessful hires? You know, which kinds of things would be good for candidates to know going into that, you know, basically that final round now? Okay, now it's time to hit the ground running for your new employer. You know, what really makes it that you've seen successful versus unsuccessful?
Well, You're talking like interview coaching advice that I would give to people?
Well, yeah. I mean, throughout the process, you know, as far as getting to those final steps of getting to the interviews and then getting the placement and the hiring and really closing the deal, you know, what have you seen be the differences between success and not?
Well, so when I see people mess up in the interview process, the most common, I mean, obviously, for obvious reasons, it's most commonly going to be fairly early in the interview process, phone screening, team screening, whatever they're doing for the first round. And usually it's one of three areas. It's either the why do you want to leave your current job question. A lot of people mess that up. Super, super, super common. The thing that's tricky about that question is that it's not really a question about why you want to leave your current job at all. it's a question about what's motivating you.
Right.
And so people will either say way too much about, you know, why they want to leave, and they'll ramble and they'll talk for 10 minutes, or they'll be so abstract as to give the impression that they're hiding something.
Sure.
You know, an answer like, oh, I'm looking for an opportunity to improve my career at a company like so-and-so. Like, of course you're looking to improve your career. Everyone's looking to improve their career. But why are you leaving your current job was the question. Like that's not a real motivation. And that gives the interviewer, like the interviewer is like, okay, I got to dig. Something's off here.
Why do
And now you spend, you know, 10 minutes out of what can be you're supposed to be a half hour screen call talking about your current job and why you want to leave and what's motivating you. And that can just kill everything for you. So what's a good answer for that? Well, you need what I tell people is you need a short, direct and blunt answer. It needs to be concrete. It needs to be so like plain and straightforward that the only possible reaction to it from the interviewer is, oh, okay, that makes sense. That's what you want. That's the perfect response to this question. You get that response to your answer to why do you want to leave your current job, you've nailed that question as best as anybody can. Mm-hmm. It's one of those things where the you know, more info you give, the more context you have to provide, the more complex of a story you're telling, the more danger you're in. So you need to find a way to simplify that down to its real sort of discrete sort of essence. And for most people, I find if we're talking about that young and up and comer sort of candidate, you know, profile, you're gonna have somebody who is just not getting the growth they want. Now, if it is purely a money thing, right? Like I feel like I'm underpaid. That can be a little. Some companies don't mind that. Other companies really don't like that at all. Like I'm looking for someone that's motivated more for money, or I'm worried if I were to bring you in and give you the money you want, and someday somebody else is going to call you and offer you more, and I'm going to lose you. If money is the only thing keeping you where you are, then like that's too risky for me to want to hire you. And candidates often don't like to hear that. You know, I mean, obviously we're all working for money here. If it wasn't for cash, none of us would be doing what we'd be doing. We'd all live in Hawaii and sleep on the beach every night. But the, you know, from an interviewing perspective, I mean, you being able to talk about growth instead, right? Talk about your career goals and whether you can achieve them at your current company or not. I mean, that's where you want to go. Or you'll have situations where like the business isn't doing well. That's a really common one. I'm nervous about, you know, the health of the business I'm working for. You could just talk about how excited you are about the new tech. Like one of my clients I've been working with recently, it's a new form of geothermal energy they've come up with. Fascinating product. And so you get a lot of people that are really passionate about green energy, you know, that are like, I'm not working in that space now. I would love to be. I've always been interested in it. I'm a real big believer in it, you know, that kind of thing. That's a common reason. Yeah. I mentioned there were two other things. I don't know how much time we have, though. It's about 2 o'clock now.
Let's do it. It's important stuff.
I have a person I'm supposed to talk to at 2 here. So let me just message them real quick.
And don't worry, we will wrap it up pretty quick.
Oh, no, I mean, it's. I'll just tell them I need 15 minutes or something. Right.
I think I have something I got to go to as well.
Okay, well, I can't. I don't think I'm actually connected with them on LinkedIn, so I can't message them quickly. But anyway.
Getting the behind-the-scenes life of a recruiter as we speak.
Yeah, right? You know, actually, now that I'm thinking about it, I think this was like I'll call you in the afternoon on Friday, you know, kind of a thing where there's no determined time, you know?
Right.
Anyway, second area where I see people mess up, money. I'll find that people often can be either way too aggressive when it comes to trying to negotiate the comp, or they'll be way too passive. And both of those can be turnoffs from companies. If you're way too passive and you're offering all sorts of concessions all the time, and I understand, you know, I don't know everything, blah, 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 it can imply that you're not as valuable of a candidate, and companies will kind of stall longer, and it can that lack of urgency and lack of sort of knowing your worth is taken as a sign of a lack of confidence in your abilities, and that can hurt you. Or if you're way too aggressive, people think you're just jerking them around, and they're like, okay, this is a waste of time. This is somebody that they're not engaging with this in a reasonable way. So, you know, generally in a negotiation, you don't want to be the first one to give a number. That can be very difficult to do if you're a candidate and the company asks you, what do you want? But talking about money and negotiation and the salary comp stuff, and that's a longer call probably. You guys might want to have me back for that later, but the comp piece, there's a lot of discussion about it. You talk to five different recruiters, you'll get five different answers on like the best way to do this. But in my personal opinion, I like setting expectations for comp very, very early. And if comp is a deal breaker, let it be a deal breaker. Don't be afraid to ask for your number. And if they say no, then just, you're not going to get that job. But if you wouldn't have left for not that number anyway, then like you weren't going to get the job anyway. You know what I'm saying? You weren't going to accept the job if they offered it at a lower number than X. So the third area where I see people mess up is questions at the end. At the end, they'll say, do you have any questions for us? If you don't have any questions prepared, that's kind of taken as a sign that you're not really interested.
Yep, it is.
You know, I mean, it's really the question and answer section of the interview. Do you have any questions for us? And oftentimes, that's the only time in the interview where they let you drive, you being the candidate. And you can learn a lot about how somebody thinks by the types of questions they ask and how they follow up. And what's important to them, and what they're interested in. Having taken the time to have questions prepared, that can be really critical.
And I just want to add on to that, and just as from the employer side, I can't say that enough how important that is, Ted. That when I'm interviewing a candidate, their questions at the end, because like you said, that's the only time where I basically hand over the microphone and I say, hey, what do you want to know? I've done my best to tell you about the company and why you're being hired, but what's important to you? You know, help me understand where your head's at, and you know, what concerns you have, and I'm going to try to answer them for you the best I can. And if you don't have any, then it tells me maybe you haven't really thought a whole lot about it. I mean, it looks cool on paper to you, but you're like, yeah, you know, I'll take a shot at it. Why not?
Right.
That's not what I want. I want somebody that's going to be in it for the long haul with us. So
oftentimes the person who gets the job is not the best qualified person. It's whoever is the most prepared.
Yeah.
You know, and that just takes time to do it.
I was going to say, I know we're about to wrap, but Alex, we should probably have Ted back on for another episode where we talk all about like interview prep and stuff like that. That'd be a really good one.
Sure. Yeah. I could talk for hours about it. I do a lot of coaching for the people that I work with, and it's all, none of it's stuff I wouldn't want the employer to hear. I mean, it's all very sort of getting people out of that, you know, robot mode. People go into robot mode with interviews a lot, where they're, you know, they're trying to tell the interviewer what they want to hear. And so they're kind of constantly sort of like, did you like that answer? Okay, I'll give you more of that. Oh, you didn't like that. Okay, I won't give you more of that. And it's there's this weird sort of dance that's happening. Everyone's radar is sort of super high, and getting them out of that mode and into more of a, you know, this is like, I think sometimes just telling candidates, this is what is attractive about your background. This is why they're interested in you.
Yeah.
People sometimes don't know. They have no idea. I have no idea why this company wants to talk to me. They want to looking to pay me more money. Sure, I'll talk to them, but like I don't really understand like what I think I know why I'm good at my job, and they must think that I'm good at my job. But like I don't know why, what it is about my background and their needs that sort of intermesh. And so getting the conversation, getting them thinking about that rather than, you know, whatever else they're thinking about is a big part of the prep. It's the goal is to scare the pants off people. It's not to, you know, actually like they need to come out of prep and be like, oh my God, I'm not ready for this interview. I need to do all this research now. I need to start thinking this. I need to practice. And when you do that, you have somebody that's taking it seriously, that's really genuinely looking at this job and thinking about whether it's a good fit for them.
Well, just being able to be a good, you know, interviewer, presenter goes a long ways too, because it's not only just you interviewing for that job. Like, I mean, Kyle, I mean, how many times have you met with a new client and you're interviewing for a new project, right? You're not trying to get a, you are trying to get a job, right? But they're paying you as a business, not a person. So, you know, if you're not going to be a grunt for your whole career, like you're going to be in those positions in construction where you're going to be talking to a new client, trying to get new work. And it's similar, but different, right? I mean, it's, you're going to have to go through the practice, right? So.
It's a muscle. You have to exercise it. It does atrophy. I've talked to some, even just recently, just some people in my mind right now, that people that are incredibly intelligent and hardworking, people that have these fantastic resumes, and they haven't interviewed in 35 years, and they have an interview and it goes really badly, like really bad, like real sort of like amateur mistakes. And it's just because they've been so used to being competent and being known as a competent person that they're not focused on selling themselves. You know, they're not thinking about how what they're saying is going to be interpreted. They go in thinking like, why do you want to leave your current job? I'll just tell them the truth. Well, and then you get in there and you start talking and you're like, well, maybe I shouldn't say so much of this, or maybe it's not very diplomatic to say so much of that. And they'll have like five different reasons why they want to leave or why they left. And now you're getting into five different things. You don't want to do that. You want to have one thing. Like it's just a lot of people just really don't, they're not thinking about how what they're saying is going to be interpreted, because they haven't had to do that in a long time. So it is a muscle. You have to exercise it. You have to think about how you want to communicate these things. And if you're going to go into an interview and you haven't prepped at all, it's almost certainly not going to go very, very well.
Very good. Well, Ted, any last piece of advice here before we wrap it up?
No, my website is not functioning at all. I don't have a website. So I'm not doing this to market business for my firm or anything like that. This is just for fun for me. But if you want to send me an email, it's ted@keyportsearch.com. You can also find me on LinkedIn, Ted Keyport. Definitely happy to chat with people. You know, obviously my main focus is on my practice, but always happy to connect with fans of your guys' show if people have more questions. But yeah, I'd be happy to come on again if you guys want me later, and we can talk more about interview prep and kind of working your way through a hiring process.
Awesome. Well, yeah, thanks so much, Ted.
All right. Fans, I gotta run. I gotta go check my fan mail. I'll see y'all later.
Yep, very good. And don't forget, listeners, DM us for any upcoming jobs, opportunities, connections. Also, if you want to get a hold of Ted, hit up Matt or myself, and we will get you in touch through recruiting means. So thanks again.
Rock on. Good luck, thanks, guys.